Tonight, I'm going to shoot a video covering the most important factors that lead to success with the tin whistle. My goal is to do this really fast and do it in one take because you can watch this as many times as you find it helpful. That's also why I'm reading off my notes. So, one of the hardest things about our tin whistle is honestly not learning the music, which is what feels so overwhelming. It's actually getting your student to make a decent tone out of their tin whistle. It's really not learning and memorizing where the notes go on the staff and where to put our fingers. It's actually making the music sound good. And so that's what I would like to address first. Few realize that our low D with all six fingers down is a rich low note because it is so hard to play. This is what a low D sounds like. Often for our kids, it sounds like this. The two reasons you're not going to be able to hit these slow, these low, sweet notes, and this is really, really important, is because number one, your fingers aren't actually covering the holes. This is especially hard for our littles as they're kind of still developing that coordination. The pads of our fingers should be completely covering the hole. So that's the number one reason we get squeaks and we don't get those sweet low notes. The other reason is that we're blowing way too hard. And I think a lot of us are telling our students and we're telling our classes to blow softly, but I don't think we have a good concept of what softly really is. When I taught class last week, I felt like we had a lot of success with this concept where I would ask our students, do we blow hard? And they would say, no. And I would say, well, do we blow soft? And they would say, also no. And I would say, how do we blow? And we came up with this term called whisper blow. It is the most gentle blow we can use with the tin whistle. And that's where we find success. And so if you'll notice, as I blow this very difficult to play low D, I am just barely blowing into the tin whistle. And you can see even when I started that note, it squeaked a little bit because I'm not used to playing it. So when you play a note, and particularly those involving the right hand, the low hand, you want to make sure that you properly cover all of the holes with the pads of your fingers, place your lips and not your teeth on the mouthpiece, and very, very gently blow. And so you see that last time I blew a little bit harder and I was able to hit that high D. So, moms, it's important to help your littles practice tin whistle and to sit with them. This is something you can practically do to help them play well. Make sure their fingers are completely covering the holes and help them to blow very gently. They will not come through, your Bcedarians are not going to come through this first 6 weeks when learning music, if this is their first exposure. But if you can help them how to learn, help them learn how to blow a note properly and get a good sweet tone out of it, then every time we address tin whistle, they're going to find more and more success, and we're going to enjoy listening to them play a lot more, and they're going to enjoy learning a lot more. So now that we've covered how to properly note and blow a tin whistle, we're going to talk about the notes themselves. Our book addresses the melody first, but I actually think it's a little easier to address rhythm. I have a goofy YouTube video that I posted. I was going to sing the song for you, and I looked it up, and it's on YouTube, and I think that will save us some time. It's called Rhythm Lesson, and it's by Sing to Learn. The cat is going in the room. See, this is live. The cat is going to go wake up the baby. It's called Rhythm Lesson by Sing to Learn, all one word, on YouTube. And go look that up, and it's going to help you learn how the note shape tells you how long to blow or to play the note. We've learned in our book that the placement of the note on the staff tells us how high, so this is our staff, and it's going to tell us how high or how low to play the note, therefore where we put our fingers, but the shape of the note tells us how long we blow, or how long or short to play the note. Our time signature for the 6 weeks is 4/4 time, and all you need to remember by that is there are four beats for every measure, And if you'll remember, a measure is where we draw two straight lines, and then all the notes that are inside of this compile our measure, okay? So for every measure, we have four beats total. And so we can kind of think of these almost as numbers. This is our whole note, and it has four beats. When we see a half note, right, a half of the whole four-beat measure, half of a whole is two beats. We have a quarter note, which is only one beat, and then an eighth note, and this is where it gets really tricky because now we're using two fractions. An eighth note is actually like a half of a beat. So if we think of this as like a fraction, moms, there and bigger kids, there are four beats total in every measure because we're in 4/4 time, and we are in this whole 6 weeks. And so we use these notes to make up four beats for every measure. So we can either have one whole note alone, only in the measure. We can have two half notes in a measure. We can have one quarter note in a measure. Four quarter notes in a measure. Or we can have eight eighth notes in a measure. So I kind of think of it as a fraction. I think of it as a pizza. This is a whole measure. And so that's a whole note. If we divide it in half, we have half notes and quarter notes. And I don't even know if that's helpful. It's probably not. So I'm going to keep moving. I'm sure you're thoroughly confused. So that's why I wanted to shoot a video, because this is hopefully going to give you the ability to go back and watch it as many times as you need to feel comfortable with it, share it with your student, whatever works for you. So again, we're using these rhythm notes to compile four beats for every measure, and they tell us how long or how short to play them. When you're looking at a staff and we see four beats for every measure, we're thinking of like an imaginary clock ticking in our minds. We don't hear it out loud, but it's ticking. In music, we call that a metronome. It tells us how fast or how slowly to play. And there are four snaps or four claps to each measure. So 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Each of those groups of four is a measure. Okay? It gives us a guideline for how long to play each note. A quarter note is four individual beats. Let me just show you what I'm talking about. I'm going to have Chris, who's off camera, keep time with our little clock metronome here, and I'm going to play a couple of different notes for you. Are you able to do that for me? So this is a G, and I'm going to play a G for a whole note. It's four beats total. 2, 3, two half notes for each measure. 1, 2, 3. Oh, you can keep going. Let's do quarter notes. He's getting tired. Thank you, Chris. Here we go. So that's two measures of quarter notes, and we're going to go for the eighth note. Okay, well, last time. Okay, so that's really what we're talking about when we're talking about how long or how short to play the note. So you can see as we kept time, you can teach your students to clap or snap, or you can do it for them. That's how we know when we say, oh, play for four beats, play for two beats, play for one beat. You know that there are four snaps or claps for every measure, and these notes tell us how long to play them. Okay, so that I think is the trickiest section here is rhythm and explaining rhythm, and the next part is going to be talking about the names of the notes as assigned to the staff and how that tells us where to put our fingers. So this is a treble clef, and all you need to know is that tells us what the names of each space and each line are. Because as we write notes on each of these places, that's what tells us where to put our fingers. So we look at this, an A, and we know it plays like this. And if it were written higher on a B, we know that we go one note higher. Okay, and I'll show you that in just a moment. This is all in your book. It's really, let's see, it's this page. In your book, it's in the back, in your CC, whatever they call it, the manual. Okay, and we have this cute little saying in our book that I think is really helpful. And it says, when a note is on a line, every good boy does fine. When a note is on a space, it spells face. F-A-C-E. So watch this. I'm going to take out that measure line because it's not helpful. There it is. Okay, so what we're going to do, every good boy does fine. Watch this. So when a note is on a line, every good boy does fine. Okay, and when a note is on a space, watch this, it spells face. And look what we have. We have our scale. So what's important to remember about notes is they're assigned letter names, but they stop at G and then they go back to A. So it goes A, B, C, D, E, F, G. So on this staff, we're showing it start at E. I'm going to throw in a D down here because that's actually the lowest note we play on Tin Whistle. But what we have on the line is E, and then watch what happens. F, G, A, B, C, D, E, F, and it just keeps going and going. And once you start going up here, you change clefs. Okay? So this is what it looks like on a scale, and that's why this page in your book is helpful. Because it tells you if a note is D, and I know you can't see that, so it's right there, it tells you, look right here, you cover up all the holes. Okay, so the note, where it is on the line or the space, is going to tell you where to finger, put your fingers on your tin whistle, and then these are going to tell you for how long or how short to play those notes. We're going to see, because we're in the key of D, on this tin whistle, you'll see these little sharps, and technically, the F is going to be an F sharp, and the C is going to be a C sharp. And we don't need to get into what that means. The best way to explain that is it's a little higher than an F, it's a little higher than a C. The sharps and the flats are all the black keys on a piano. So I think we're about done. So we're going to put this all together. Four quarter notes in a measure that are G's. We're just going to make this work here, just like I was in class with you. Okay? So four quarter notes that are G's, right? So every good, so that's a G, and that's our quarter note. There's a line there. Okay, so four quarter notes that are G's sound like this. If I had written, keep losing everything. If I had written half notes, let's just do that. If I had written half notes, so again, now we're going to kind of empty that little space out. We're going to take out these notes here. I know that's super confusing. Okay, if we had half notes, and they were still G, and this is still in a measure, they would sound like this. If that were a whole note, let's say this was gone. Mm-hmm. Can you guess what it would sound like if it was a whole note? I know that's super hard to see. If it were a whole note that looks like this, but written on the line, it would sound like this. And an eighth note, because there are eight notes in a measure, would sound like this. so that's really about it. One of the best ways to practice at home is for moms to do exactly what I just did. Draw a staff on a sheet of paper, write a random note first, just like separated, I would say. I would say either practice the rhythm separately, just pick one note and practice the rhythm with the beats, and you can clap your hands for them or snap. And then I would also practice the notes on a scale, and you can just write a random note on a scale and say, let's see, that's a C sharp. And do like that and say, what is that note? And they'll say, oh, that's a, that's a D. They'll say, oh, that's a D, and that's a high D, and it actually looks like this. And you can ask them to play it. And because it's a high D, we blow a little bit harder. Probably wasn't a good example. Let's try this. A G. Let's give another example. You'll draw a note, you know, on the second line, every good G, boy does fine. And you'll say, play that note. And then they can take turns and draw a note and then play the note. And you're going to be using your book guide for all of that. So I love music. I want you moms and kiddos to love music. I found that once my girls, who are 6 and 7, learned how to play the notes properly, to cover up the finger holes and to blow very gently, I enjoyed listening to them practice a lot more, and they enjoyed playing a lot more, and I really think that that's the goal. They weren't shrieking and squeaking quite as bad, and it made just the whole thing a lot more enjoyable. So if you have any questions at all, or you want my help during lunch or recess hour, please don't hesitate to reach out to me. I love this stuff, and I am super happy to help. So we're going to go put the kids to bed, and go Stros! Alrighty, there's one more thing I missed, and so I wanted to make sure I got it in there, and it is how to practice. So before I even get into my bullet points, there's two real big things. Number one, make sure that the song that you choose is playable for your student. Too often times we pick stuff that's too ambitious. Mary Had a Little Lamb is probably still very, very challenging for a 4 or 5 year old. So if you're playing with them at home, I would encourage you to just look at the scale. Pick up that page in the back of our CC handbook, or the manual, whatever it's called, and that I showed earlier with the finger holes, and just get them to play that scale. And if they can just slowly and painfully, you know, put their fingers on all the appropriate notes and play the scale, they're doing very, very well. So that's the first thing, is just make sure you pick good music. Make sure the music is large enough for them to read. Don't just kind of randomly print it off the internet or take a screenshot with your phone. Make sure it's nice and big and easy to read. And then here's our practice method. The first thing we do is learn the notes. It sounds kind of silly, but if you're learning the notes for the first time when you're reading your music, it's not a good use of time. So go through and point to each note and make sure your student knows, even if they can't get there quickly, they know that a G is 3 fingers. If we can't see a G, even with our little cue above it with the finger holes, and know that we need to be moving to put our 3 fingers on the tin whistle, we're not going to make any progress. So that's the first thing, is know the notes. The second thing is learn or identify the rhythm. Go through with your student and just make sure they understand, okay, that's going to be 1 beat, that's going to be 2 beats, that's a rest, which means we count a beat, but we don't play. And just identify the parts of the song. The third thing, go very, very slow. When I say slow, I mean much slower than the song would ever be played live. We have a tendency to want to play quickly and then just stop and get really stuck in a song. So take the song very, very slowly at first until you master it, and then pick up the speed. The fourth thing is to just practice one section at a time. Practice one section at a time. It doesn't need to be one measure at a time, just whatever sounds good to your ear as being one section at a time. Do not play through the whole song over and over and over again if you have multiple hiccups throughout a song. Pick the first line and go over it until you got it, and then tackle the next one. And at the very end, you'll put it all together, still play very slowly. And once you can play the whole song very slowly, you can begin to pick up the tempo. And the very last, and this may be most important with some of our older kids, is it's very, very helpful to play with a metronome. And remember, the metronome is that clicking sound that I showed you earlier. You can find them online. Just search free metronome on your computer. You can easily find a metronome app on your phone at the App Store. So download that and then just find the clicks that sound like they are a good beat for you or a good speed, and you can play with the metronome. And that's also really helpful if you're playing very slowly to slow it way down, and then as you practice, increase it each time you play the song. So that's it. That's a quick overview on how to practice. I hope that helps you feel like your time at home is more efficient and more useful. And I hope it helps us help our kids tackle these songs.